Naples First Church of the Nazarene. I'm John Snowball, standing in for Pastor Mark Cook this morning, who is away on a motorcycle trip for the weekend. Yes.
Which I'm with it.
Yes. And we'd like to welcome you. Do we have any first-time visitors here this morning? Anybody here for the first time? All right. Well, it is June the 17th, Father's Day, this morning, and we did want to wish a happy Father's Day to all the fathers who are here. Could I see the hands of everyone who's a father? Yes. You know, my wife and I married a little too late in life to have children, but I did find this under my pillow last night for my dogs. We want to wish you a happy Father's Day today. Now, I'd like to ask, who here today is the oldest father among us? Alan, would you please come up? Who's been a father for 50 years? No, you're not the oldest father. He's going to help me out. He's not the oldest father. Who's been a father the longest here? Who's been a father for 50 years? Let me see your hand. 50 years, okay. Let's go 55 years. 55 years?
We have a couple of them.
Okay, two people, 55 years. 58 years?
Nope.
56 years? 56 years, John? You 56 years of father?
56.
Okay. Well, John, congratulations this morning. The oldest father in our midst. Let's have a hand. Whoa, wait, whoa, whoa. Sorry about the letdown here, but I think we might have somebody here who's been a father longer than that. Have you been a father for 56 years, Pastor?
Over 70.
Over 70 years. Let's hear it for Pastor Dexter Westphal. Now at the other end of the scale, the other end of the spectrum, who is the most recent father that we have in our midst? Who's a father less than a year? Let me see your hand if you've been a father for less than a year. Okay, 1 year. Anybody been a father for 1 year? Year and a half? 2 years? 2 years? Okay. You were a father 3 weeks ago? Praise God. Let's have a hand. The most recent father on this. Congratulations to you. You know, fatherhood is so very important to us, and I think I shared last year all the ways that God could have chosen to reveal himself to us. It was predominantly as our Heavenly Father. Amen. So I just want to encourage all of you fathers today, our prayers are with you, that you rise to the occasion and be the men of God that God's created you and destined you to be. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Also, in your bulletin this morning, you'll find this insert. And it is an insert detailing several activities. There's nowhere on the insert that it tells us that these are activities for the children's ministry this summer. Now, anybody is welcome to come, but we just wanted you to be aware that these are activities for the children's ministry, okay? Well, thank you, worship team, for that opening worship song. You got our hearts tuned in. Let's bow our heads and invite the presence of the Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you for your presence here today. You said wherever two or more were gathered in your midst, Lord Jesus, that you would be here. And so with our heads bowed, with our hearts bowed before you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we acknowledge your presence here today. May everything that's said, every note that's played, every note that's sung, be to the praise of your glorious name. We delight to be your children. We delight to meet with you in your presence. And all God's children said, amen. Gather around these teens that have come to the altar to pray who are going to teen camp this week. Thank you, Lord. Let's bow our heads, continuing in an attitude of worship and prayer. God, you are great. There is none like you. We bow our hearts, we bow our heads, we bow our knees before you. We proclaim boldly today that you are our God. There is no other. We delight to give you our worship today. We delight to sing praises to your holy name. We delight that you love us and that you're a good Father. And Lord, as these teens who are about to embark on an adventure in teen camp this coming week, have come to the altar to kneel before you. Oh God, it's in such settings that you meet with your children. It's in such settings that you touch hearts and change lives in the way that only you can do. We lift each and every one of them up before you, and all of the workers and all of those who will assist in every aspect of the teen camp. We pray that you would quicken your holy angels about them, that those angels would be swift and powerful, hearkening to the mighty voice of your word. As we pray, Holy Father, you would direct and equip them to guard, protect, bear up, defend, watch over, keep, and preserve each and every one of these in their ways. We pray that those ministering spirits sent to minister for the heirs of salvation would minister light, life, truth, health, healing, wholeness, wellness, and completeness both to and for these heirs of salvation. We pray that you would meet with them in a wonderful way, that you would change hearts and lives, that each and every one of these teens who returns from that summer camp would come back yet one degree closer to your image and likeness. May they have a good time, a fun time together. May the fellowship be sweet. May your presence be real and tangible as we commit them into your hands, Father, with thanksgiving for them on this Father. Day in Jesus' name. And continuing in an attitude of prayer this morning, it's with a heavy heart that I'm going to share this next bit of information with you. As I told you at the beginning of the service, Pastor Mark and several of the men had gone on a motorcycle trip for this Father's Day weekend, and unfortunately there was an accident in the mountains. And Harley Hogue was riding, very conservative rider from what I understand, and lost the brakes on his motorcycle, went out of control on a mountain road, and he went down into a ravine. Pastor Mark and the other men were able to talk with him and communicate with him for almost an hour before the paramedics arrived, got him out of the tree, and then he was life-flighted to a hospital. It's my understanding his wife was on the way flying up there when he had a cardiac arrest and went into the presence of the Lord. And so this morning as we pray, let's remember Harley Hogue on this Father's Day. I understand his children are all grown, but his family has to really be hurting and missing him today on this Father's Day. So let's remember them. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, you are the God of all comfort. So many things happen in this life that we have no explanation for. We don't understand them. And the reality is, oh God, you call us to live every day in a state of readiness, because none of us knows when you're going to issue that call to us to come home to be with you. We thank you for Harley. We thank you that the report is by those around him that he was a godly man. We thank you for the great salvation that you purchased for us with the life and the blood of your very own son. And we plead the blood of Jesus over Harley Hogue and his family this morning. And by faith, we apply that blood. We thank you that he has gained entrance into his eternal abode with you. And oh God, as you look out over the sea of souls that are gathered before you this morning in adoration and worship, we pray that you would make your countenance shine especially on Harley this morning, that he would know that he's being thought of, that he would know that he's being remembered here. And oh God, that you would stretch forth your precious hand and touch the hearts of the family who are grieving the loss of their father, husband. I'm sure he has siblings as well. Don't know if his parents are still alive, but oh God, won't you go to the Hogue family now and give them your peace and your comfort as only you can. Thank you, Lord. Without you and the hope of salvation that we have in Jesus Christ, what meaning does this have? But thank you that it all finds context in you. This life, this world is not the end of the road for us. And we thank you for the eternal destiny. Eye has not heard, seen, ear has not heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things that you prepared for those who love you, but you reveal them to us by your Spirit. And as we think this morning of families that are suffering and need comfort, we also would like to lift up Eric and Heather Madden and their family at the recent loss of their 19-month-old son, Eric, in a drowning incident. And won't you continue to comfort the family? Won't you continue to draw them close to you where that comfort is found? Won't you continue to reveal yourself to them in new and deep ways? And thank you that as a result of this child coming home to heaven to be with you, that this family will come closer to you. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And God, there are so many in our midst today who have health needs and health issues. And as we lift them up to you by name and think of them, we remember this morning that it was not too long ago that we got word that Deborah and Tim Cully's grandson, Caleb, had a cancer that was moving in his body and ravaging his body and found in several areas of his body. And through prayer and through praise and through your mercy, oh God, you have turned back this cancer, and the report is today that he is in total remission. Thank you and praise you. You're a great God and a God who does hear and answer prayer. And so it's with that hope that we lift up to you this morning those in our midst with cancer and other health issues. We lift up Michael Adams with cancer, Joe Palomo's mother with cancer, Jose Palomo, I should say, his mother with cancer, and Dr. Nixon's wife, Kay, who's recovering from surgery. We lift up Kevin and Holly Morton's new baby with health issues. We lift up Melvin Staggs with you this morning with terminal cancer. We lift up to you Jack Aviard with cancer, Audrey Brown with cancer, Alan Sagan's father, who's battling cancer. We lift up to you our sister and dear friend, Kathy Mayo, who's back in New Jersey now, finishing her treatment and battling against cancer. Thank you, oh God, for the inroads that have been made in defeating that disease in her body. We pray for Jim Ackerson this morning. Lift up special prayer for him as he's battled so long with pain and problems with his back, that you might, in your mercy, touch him and relieve that suffering. We pray for Fritzy Pittenger this morning, who's had ongoing health issues. And it's my understanding, Lord, at the prayers of many and at the mercy of God, that she's being released from the nursing home to go home. She's turned the corner and is doing better. Thank you, God. And for Scott Shirk, oh God, this young man so many times has battled against cancer, and so many times you granted a miraculous touch and healing deliverance from cancer. He battles yet again, Father. Won't you please have mercy and touch Scott? Pray for Sherry Yall this morning with health issues, and for Don Sterling this morning with health issues. You, Lord Jesus, were wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, chastised for our peace. And with the stripes that you bore, we have access to the gift of healing. And so we ask this morning in your name. And Lord, there are many unspoken and personal needs in our midst this morning. Rod and Krista Cross have expressed a need. Woody Malone and his family. Carly, Chrissy, Destiny Case, Linda Casey. Each one of these has a private and personal need. Lord, we don't know what they are, but you know what they are. And so we lift these up to you, knowing that they are known and loved by you, and ask for your touch, your presence, and your mercy, that you would come to them and be the answer to the need that they have. We have those in our midst who are searching for employment. We think of Dodd Estes this morning, and for Jose, who also is looking, has a job situation, and would also like prayer that he could be a safe driver as well. We pray for Honey Thompson this morning as she continues to wait upon you for your direction for her life in the days ahead. And we thank you for that. We pray also this summer we have a mission trip slated to the nation of Nicaragua with Ride Nature Ministries. Won't you continue to breathe upon this ministry, to keep your hand upon Mark and Shannon, all of those laboring with them to take the gospel into all the world. We pray that you would assemble the team that's going to go to Nicaragua, that you would go before and clear out anything physical or demonic that might lie in the path of a successful ministry, of a successful journey. We pray and labor before you, O God, and cry out for souls to be saved and won to the Lordship of Jesus Christ as a result of this outreach. And though many of us cannot physically go and join the team, we can come alongside them and be a part of this as one unit, as one body, with one heart, one voice, and one mind, joining together to declare that you, the Lord of glory, live. And won't you confirm the word that is declared there with signs and wonders and miracles and healings following. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. We think of military personnel all around our country, around the world, many of whom are in harm's way. And those to whom we have close relationship this morning, we lift before you by name: Joshua Sams, Sam Althouse, Rick Scannon, Billy Ray Musselman, Matthew Donovan, Tony Hess, Aaron Fisher and his family, David Liddell, and Kurt Vollmer this morning. Won't you keep your hand upon each and every one of them? Guide their steps in the days ahead and use them for your glory, we pray. We pray for our shut-ins this morning: Laura Shepherd, Trudy Harden, Sylvia Hausman, Dexter Westhaver, Twyla Hutzel, and Bud Witherby. Won't you continue, Lord, as these are in their old age now and many times unable to get out and to get about and have the mobility that they once had, that you would come alongside and be a great Savior and a great friend that sticks closer than a brother to them in these, their latter years. May they be the sweetest, juiciest, most wonderful years. May they have sweet times with you in prayer, and use them continually until the day that you call them across that threshold into your presence for your glory. In all these things, we praise you, we thank you. You are God, there is no other. Thank you that you hear our prayers, that you answer when we call. Thank you, God, for answering our prayers this morning. For we've asked them in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen and amen. Thank you. As you return to your seats this morning, I'd like to ask the ushers to come forward. And we'd like to receive the morning tithes and offerings, tithes which belong to God, the offerings which we desire to give God over and above the tithe. I'm reminded of a verse in Proverbs chapter 3, two verses in Proverbs chapter 3, 9 and 10, that say this. And as I read these verses, mix your faith with them. Honor the Lord with thy substance and the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. Amen. Who said that? Who said that? God said that, didn't he? So let's believe God and take him in his word this morning. Be blessed as you give. There's a song that's coming up for the offertory here this morning that we would like to dedicate to Harley Hogue and his family this morning.
as we are about to sing a song, realizing this is Father's Day, I just want to encourage all of you fathers, whether you're sons and daughters, or real small, or a lot older, and grown themselves into adulthood, that you continue to look to God for direction. He gives us strength as fathers. We have a unique responsibility that God has given to all of us. And this responsibility never ends. We are fathers from the day we first become a father to the day we die. And it's a tremendous responsibility, and it can be tremendously rewarding. So I thank you for all your fathers, and just ask that you continue to serve Him and serve your children as God wants.
Low down the chariot, let me ride it. Low down the chariot, let me ride it. Low down the chariot, let me ride. 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 Low down the chariot, let me ride.
Ride on,
ride on, King Jesus.
Ride on,
ride on, King Jesus.
Ride on,
ride on, the conquering King. I wanna go to heaven in the morning.
Ride on,
ride on, King Jesus.
Permit me to ask a few questions of the young people what their goals in life are, what their objectives are. I met a businessman at dinner that night who said, "You sure made a mess out of yourself, didn't you?" I said, "What do you mean?" "Well," he said, "you know what you did. You tried to take over the meeting of those young people." I said, "I beg your pardon." All I did was ask them what their goals in life were and why they were here. And they took over from there. He said, "I'm sorry, I beg your pardon." I thought I had become a part of a lion's den. But you know, I've been there now in Merrill Gardens 4.5 years. I testify, I witness, I pray with them. I take 1.5 hours every morning to have my devotions. Why not? I don't work. I will be 95 in October. I can't deny that. But I love the Lord with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. Right. If I'm even taking him over, I'll take over. I'll remind them that I'm not taking over. I'm just doing what I was told. But you know, I have served the Lord since a teenage boy. I went to the altar in a United Brethren church. I was reared in a Methodist church. Had two uncles who were Methodist ministers in Ohio. But you know what? I sought the Lord in the United Brethren church. And I went forward on Sunday morning, but only a month. And an old fella come up, bless his heart. He didn't know any better, I guess. He said, "Sonny, did you pray?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Get up, you're saved." I didn't have a witness. But when I was 16, I had the witness of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. And felt the call to be a minister. I've tried to mind the Lord for over 70 years, and he hasn't failed me yet. Praise the Lord. Amen.
My father, his name was Nun, not like Nun as in none, but N-U-N. And he was from the tribe of Ephraim. That's my family roots. We don't know exactly what happened to him, but there's really no record of him past Egypt. And so many believe that he didn't go with the Israelites. Many believe that he died in slavery. So Moses, he kind of became my spiritual father to me. And I learned many different things from Moses during this journey. I remember one of the first things was, we got out, and there's this huge sea in front of us. Well, we know what happened there. He raised his hands, he raised his staff. It was separated. We walked across some dry land. And I remember thinking that either this dude's whacked out or God's on his side. There's something going on here. I got to get to know this guy. So I kept trying to get to know him. And you know what happened? As I kept to get to know him, he became like a father to me. And I became like a son to him. He taught me so much. One of the things that he taught me, if we could bring it up, from thousands of years ago, but I learned a PowerPoint, Don't act like you're not impressed. A godly father does what is right, no matter what. That's one of the things that he taught me. And he just didn't say that to me, he did it. There's this time when he received the law from God, and he went up on this mountain, Mount Sinai, for 40 days. Some people have a hard time being in the presence of God for 4 minutes. He went for 40 days. Hopefully there's rivers or something up there. I don't know where the man bathed. But I sat at the base of the mountain along with some of the elders. And we waited on him. And when he came down, as Moses wrote in Exodus 32, I said to Moses, I go, it sounds like war is going on in the camp. And Moses said to me, that's not the sound of victory. That's not the sound of defeat. He goes, that's the sound of singing. So we went to the camp. We hurried there. Aaron, Moses had left in charge, told the people to collect all the gold. He was going to make them a golden calf. And he did. Aaron, his brother, I decided that day, I didn't want to be like that. And I remember thinking, as it says here, godly fathers does what is right no matter what. Moses could have easily pleased all those people, but he went against the grain. And he said, no, this is not right. The law that God just gave me, thou shalt have no other gods before you. Thou shalt not worship false gods. Moses did what was right. He could have probably been the most popular person in all of the camp. If he said, this is a great idea. They might have played Rocky and celebrated. Who knows? But he went against the grain. Another thing that Moses taught me was a godly father is open to God and seeks him with all of his heart. He is open to God and seeks him with all of his heart. There's this one time where the Amalekites, they saw us. They came up upon us. They came up behind us and they wanted to go to war with us. And Moses said to me, he goes, Joshua, I want you to lead up some men, and you are in charge of this battle. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I just like this song, Rocky, I can't really fight, But I'll do it, whatever, And then Moses said to me, he goes, well, when they come tomorrow, when they approach our camp, I'm going to go up on this hill and I'm going to raise my hands. Thanks, Moses. That helps a lot, That's what he did. And you see what happened was, when he had his hands raised up and the staff in his hand, we kept on winning. But when his hands slowly dropped because he was getting tired, because he was getting weary, we started to lose. He had an open heart to God. By him throwing his hands in the air, he was saying, God, I need your power to enable me. I need what you have. We can't do this on our own. Our man-made armies are not going to cut it. We need you. We invite you in. And I might look like a fool. All the Amalekites and even half the people in my own camp might be saying, why is this dude doing the touchdown sign? But that's what he did because he knew it was right. He had an open heart and he sought God with him. And I remember looking up that day and seeing his hands come down a little bit. He was growing weary. We started to lose. What was amazing about it is Aaron came up to him and Hur came up to him. Aaron went on one side and he lifted up his hand and heroin on the other side. And he lifted up his other hand to God. And what that showed me that day is that sometimes as fathers, we can't always do it alone. We need the help of each other. We need the help of the church. We need God's help. We can't do it by ourselves. And they used teamwork there. It was amazing because we won that battle that day for the Lord. Next thing that Moses taught me about being a godly father is a godly father directs his children to God. He is deliberate about it. He doesn't beat around the bush. It's everything to him. It's every single thing. If you guys would like to turn with me this morning, Deuteronomy chapter 6. We'll read through verses 1 through verses 12 there. These are the commands, decrees, and law the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you're crossing the Jordan to possess. This is Moses speaking to the people. Before we get into this, in Deuteronomy chapter 4, he calls them to seek God with everything. Deuteronomy chapter 5, he brings out the Ten Commandments. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, he gives the greatest commands. He says, these are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you're crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy a long life. Let me say that again. So that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and command that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. He showed me that God wants us to enjoy life, and he didn't just want it for the people there that day. He was doing these things out of love to carry it on from generation to generation. Verse 3, he says, hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, he said this to all the people. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, and when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on your door frames of your houses and on your gates. They need to be every part of your life. Verse 10, when the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to give you, a land with large flourishing cities you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells you did not dig, and vineyards and olive groves you did not plant. Then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. One thing about my life, I lived 20 years in slavery. I spent 50 years in the desert and freedom. And then after that, I spent 40 years in the promised land. It's kind of like us as Christians today, maybe. We live a life of slavery and we find Christ and we live in freedom. And then, because of that, we go to the promised land. I'm so thankful that I had a spiritual father in Moses who took me by his side, took me under his wing. There's so many times I'd go to the tabernacle with him and pray. I would go to the mountain, and he would show me what it meant to actually get in the presence of God. The man wanted to be in the presence of God. He spent 40 days with him. He wanted to be in the presence of God. He showed me so much about what it meant to be a godly father. And I'm thankful for that. I think I just heard something. It's probably Pastor Joe in there. So I'm going to go get him real quick. And he's going to come back out. So, you know, you like twiddle your thumbs for like 30 seconds while I get him. So here we go. Mm-hmm. Hey guys, how we doing? Definitely have Joshua here.
For some reason.
Oh gosh. So my buddy Joshua, he's a good man. We go way back. You guys know I'm 26, but I'm thousands of years old, so what can I say? I'd like to share with you guys a little bit this morning, being Father's Day, what my father meant to me. And there's a lot of comparisons. When I read through the story of the Old Testament, when I read through what Moses was for Joshua, I see a lot of things that my dad did for me, and I'm ever, ever so thankful for it. Like it says in verse 4, that I may enjoy a long life. God wants me to enjoy life. My father directed me to that. Some of the first things I can tell you about my dad was his home life growing up, not saying it was absolutely horrible, but it wasn't the best always. He didn't really have much of a father. His father did, to be frank, he did a lot of pretty crappy stuff. Sad. My dad's parents got divorced when he was 12 years old. Luckily for my dad, there are spiritual mentors in his life who pointed him in the direction of God, and he found Christ. And the first thing that I said here, that Joshua said, of course, is a godly father does what's right no matter what. My dad had to make a choice who he was going to serve. As Joshua said in Numbers, choose now who you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And my dad had to make that decision early on in his life. And at a young age, my dad said that he was going to be a minister. And the things that he went through to make it through college, I was with my grandma this week, and I was in the hospital with my grandma. And praise the Lord, she has a clear report. But they ask her, they go, do you smoke? And she goes, no, I used to. You know why she quit? So she could give my dad money so he could make it through college. That's what got him through. He became a minister. He studied the Word of God so deeply. A godly father does what's right no matter what. He could have chose to stay in the life that his father had done for him. The same thing, that same generational sin kind of stuff. He could have chosen to stay in that. But instead, he said, no. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And I'm so thankful because of that. He taught me so much. So my father, let me go back here to the second thing here. My father, he became a minister. He served at a small church as associate and a youth pastor in Sharon, Pennsylvania, and then he went to Fulton First Church of the Nazarene, and then for 7 years he served at West Lafayette First Church of the Nazarene. He served as minister there. And like this says here, what Joshua said, a godly father is open to God and seeks him with all of his heart.
Amen.
Right here I have a journal that my dad left. He left a lot of journals. And in this journal has different things from his ministry. And there's so many things I can look at. There's so many things I remember from my memory. Even when I look in here, it's full of letters from people saying, thank you. Thank you for the $500 that you sent us. We're at a small church. He didn't make much of income. I remember one time, our church needed a new parking lot. There's holes everywhere. It just looked horrible. And my dad, he knew the church could afford it. He talked to my mom, and out of my family's own personal savings, they paved the parking lot without telling anybody in the church. And a funny story with that parking lot. My dad was a bigger guy, a little stronger, you know. And because we were a smaller church, we would take the TV, you know, over to the church. So one Sunday after church, after using the TV, he was carrying the TV out. And he's walking with it, and he's in the parking lot. Everybody's out there, the whole church, you know, it's after church, and his pants drop. And it's either drop the TV, or just keep it like that. Luckily, I think my mom was somewhat close, and she ran over to aid him. That showed that they worked as a team. That's not as cool as Aaron and her raising up Moses' hands, but it's close. But my father, he did many things. And I'm not saying it's his deeds that make him righteous, because he definitely showed me it's through the faith in Jesus Christ that I have.
Yes.
Some other things I remember, every week he'd go to the nursing home. People didn't see that. People didn't know about that. He kept going. And he kept visiting the people there. There's a letter in here from a man in prison that my father went every Thursday to go see. And the man in prison, my mom, she was a caseworker, and she had to go to the people's home. And the guy writes and says, "Thank you for your family. Your wife wasn't like the other caseworkers. She made a difference. She actually cared about our family." And then he thanked my dad for all that he was doing. And he talked about how because of this, he became a Christian, gave his life to Christ. I remember one time when that man was in prison, their house was looking horrible. They didn't have a man around. And my dad got a whole bunch of people and went over and he painted the place. He didn't have to do it. But he showed me what a man of God is. He was open to God, and he sought him with all of his heart. I know that there's times in his ministry and his life that he shared with me and our family, and he thought about getting out of the ministry. He wasn't making much money. We were living paycheck by paycheck, and he got discouraged from time to time. And I think maybe like Moses, his hands started to come down. But he never let up. He kept going strong. And he kept putting those hands up and he kept serving God with all of his heart. And these are things not only that he told me, but that he showed me. A godly father directs his children to God. I'm so thankful for my father. He showed me so much about true, real life. And that's life in Jesus Christ. And I remember when I was younger, we had Bible quizzing at our church. My dad just kept on pushing me, encouraging me to keep studying it, to keep going at it. And I remember finally my last year, I was a Bible quizzing champion because my dad just kept on pushing me. I missed one question all year. I only went to two meets. All the other kids went to like 11, but that's okay. I played football, so I didn't have much time to go to a ball. They were probably mad at the last meet. I got everything correct. I promise I didn't cheat. But my dad kept on pushing me to learn the Word of God. He wanted me to have that relationship with God, and he knew that God revealed himself through the Bible.
Yes.
He showed me so many things. A godly father directs his children to God. Father's Day, 1998. That's the last sermon that my dad ever preached. The name of that sermon, I have the bulletin here from still, A Rock and Roll Model. Pastor Joe, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13. And I'd like to read that verse to you, what it was about. You can turn there if you want, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13. First Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13 says this: "Be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be men of courage, be strong." And then verse 14 says, "Do everything in love." Be on your guard, stand firm in your faith, be men of courage, stand strong, do everything in love. I'm not saying that my dad was a perfect man. He had his failures. But I know that he tried doing everything in love. He was gentle. He loved for his children. And he loved them so much that he passed on that message to my brother and I to seek God with all of our hearts. To live for Christ is the best life. And I'm so thankful that he passed those things along to me. In closing, I'd just like to encourage you guys out here. This world isn't becoming a better place, as we know. Things are tough. There's a lot of kids who just aren't giving the best life. You know what God has for you. And like Moses said to Joshua, right before Joshua took over, Numbers chapter 30, he said, be strong and be courageous, for the Lord your God is with you. Yeah. Fathers, be strong, be courageous, stand in your faith. Be men of courage. I'm so thankful for what my father did for me. I'm so thankful for it. He's showing me some grace. Lord, I come before you, and I just thank you that you are our great Heavenly Father who cares so much for his children. As it says in Psalms, you personally care for your people. Matthew says that you know the number of hairs on our head. In Psalms again, it says that you knew us while we're still in the womb, God. You love us so much. We are called children of God. You are our perfect Heavenly Father. And I ask that the fathers here today, that they will look to you for guidance, that they will seek you with all of their heart, that they will be open, and that they will please you, God. That they will love you with everything, Lord. That is the best life. And as it says in Deuteronomy chapter 6, so that their children may enjoy a life. Lord, your way is the truth. Your way is the best way for us, God. And you love us so much. Like the Israelites who, living in slavery, you took them out of it. You brought them into freedom and then into the promised land. You want the same for us, Father. And I ask that we grasp that. And that we are men of courage, that we stand firm in our faith, and we are strong in you. In your name, Father, amen.
Amen.
Rocky.
Thank you.